Hey everyone, Chris the Thrift Shop Hustler here. Another episode of Merch Talk. Today is July 18th, 2018. I hope everyone is having an amazing day so far. Today I am co-host is Joe Clay. Joe, what's up?
What's up, everybody? Great day to come back and do some merch talk. And I know everybody's excited. They've been telling me about it and waiting for it to come back. And I know y'all had the first show last week, kind of like after like our little vacation we've had. So yeah, it's great to have it back and, you know, be here. Talk about some merch.
Yeah, one of the things that I was talking about last week was the fact that, you know, once, you know, if the show lapsed a week, there was a few people that would, they were wondering like, well, what's going on with the show? But when we lapsed 2 weeks, we get the people banging down the door, like, where's the show? And it actually, I was telling Nick last week that it's really nice. And we really appreciate that people care. And to me, I was like, people really care about the show. And until Margaret gets, you know, herself situated, you know, I'll be hosting the show. And Joe, you guys are all totally, you know, can host the show if you want, just let me know. I know like today was almost a day where I, you know, kids had dentist appointments and things like that. So I'm just glad my wife was the one that actually had the suggestion. It's like, well, why don't you just go earlier and then postpone it? And I'm like, man, that's a great idea. It's like such a simple idea. And it just totally crossed my mind. You're doing this full time now, huh, Joe? How's that going, man?
Man, it's going good. It's, you know, I'm trying to, I like it. I mean, you can do more, things like I'm doing. Not only merch, but I'm also doing like Etsy Printful, and I'm also starting the Createspace thing. And so I'm trying to do all kinds of stuff, you know, because I have the time for it now. So
yeah, I'm gonna be going full time in August. I'm a little scared. I talked about it a little bit last show. So I'll definitely be picking everyone's brain with that. We got some chatters in the chat room. We got Matthew Pate. What's up, man? We got Lord Ahab. Welcome. If you guys have any questions, definitely put question marks in the chat room and leave your questions, and we will try to get to them as soon as possible. Joe, you mentioned something about safe space, or what was that? Create space, you said?
Oh, create space. Yeah, create space. It's where people are making like books, but they're just using like covers. Like you just make a cover and maybe I'll say like some kind of journal, like a blank, like a journal type thing. And then the inside is all blank pages with just lines, like a notebook. And people are buying that on it. With CreateSpace, really, it's going through Amazon. So your books go on Amazon to be sold.
So is it a print on demand service?
Could you? Yeah, print on demand service. All it is, there's a couple places where you can get these templates, or you can make your own actually. And then you make your covers. Actually, you've been using Canva. They have like a book cover template, and you can put like any design on there. And then you could just put like, say you're making a book for that people that interest like drawing on there. So you could put like a drawing on there or whatever. And then you could put, this is a drawing journal. And then you upload it to CreateSpace, and then it takes like a day. They approve it, and then you go in and kind of like digital proof the book. And pretty much that's just like digital proof. Okay, it works. And then they like a couple days later that it's live on Amazon. So
yeah, that's crazy. Because I've actually heard little tricklings of that CreateSpace, but I haven't looked into it like a million things. It's like we all have so much stuff on our plate. And it's hard to do research. It took me like almost a year to get onto Redbubble and to do the Etsy Printful integration. And I wish I would have done that sooner, because everyone was like, and Margaret especially was, oh, you gotta try this. And I'm like, nah, I'm trying to figure out merch. And then, you know, when I tried Etsy Printful, it was just amazing. And I wish I would have put a lot of more time in there. So I will definitely go and check that out.
Just like really quick, the really quick benefits are is there's no tiers. There's no application process, and there's no upload limit, and your books stay on there for life because they come with an ISBN number like a regular book, so it never can be taken off unless you take it off yourself.
Right, so. Right. Well, we have a couple questions already right off the bat, but let's do it. Let's do a little paperwork here. For anyone that doesn't know, if you're not on Printful or anything like that, my affiliate link is going to be below. Definitely check that out. Click the like button at any time during this video. That helps other people find this video. If you want to retweet and all that kind of stuff, that's fine too. We want to give a huge shout out to RJ Martinez. His birthday was yesterday, Joe?
Yeah, it was yesterday.
So I've met RJ in person, and he's a great person and also a great ambassador for merch by Amazon and other print on demand. So that was actually very nice of you to do that. And if you're not joining Merch University, I'll put a link below after the show for that site that you're like one of the founders of Merch University, correct, Joe?
Yeah, I'm the founder of it.
Yeah, yeah. Dude. So you want to explain to folks at home real quick before we get to these questions about Merch University?
Merch, the whole thing behind Merch University is just mainly just to like educate people and to keep people informed about everything about merch, and just kind of just a place to come and learn, you know, university, you know, just to kind of come in place and, you know, take these classes or whatever, you know. Sometimes we'll do little classes and stuff, but just to like post things that will help people along with their merch journey.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's probably one of my favorite merch print on demand Facebook groups. And I don't do the Facebook group stuff a lot because it's just, you know, the time, and there's just drama with a lot of other groups. But I noticed that this group is a very solid group, and it's more focused on helping others and things like that, which is really awesome. So happy birthday to RJ. Also a shout out to Don Sosko, who is part of Merch University, who has sold her second shirt. And as veterans like us, I guess we can call ourselves veterans. We've been around for a while. You know, we kind of get jaded to the fact that like someone says they sold their first shirt or sold their second shirt, and you know, we're like, yeah, no, great. We've sold like what, thousands of shirts maybe at this point. So, yeah. But we want to give a shout out that's very nice. Congratulations, Don Sosko. It brings us back to think about those times that, you know, we sold our first shirt and things like that. And so I definitely want to say hi and congratulations to that. So we got two questions, and this is actually probably going to be one of them is to you specifically, Joe. So we'll get to that last. But Lord Abe Hab is asking about Merch by Amazon tiering up slots or slots left. He says he has 1,000 slots and they're all filled up. Could he do drafts and save those?
Yeah, you could definitely do drafts and save those. You know, just keep listing, keep going ahead. That's actually the smart thing to do. Just stay ahead of it. So when you do have shirts that fall off, you can either re-upload or you can just upload your new ones.
Yeah, that's great. That's something I didn't even know. And by the way, folks, I am no expert at Merch by Amazon or any of this stuff. I'm not a guru. I'm not a pillar. I'm not any of that funky weird stuff people say. You know, I'm learning just like everyone else. So, you know, your questions are very appreciated here on the show, because I learn stuff, Joe learns stuff, everyone, we all learn together. And I think that's one of the great things about this show. So the next question is from Matthew Pate. This is specifically towards you, Joe. It says, do you have an Amazon seller account, or is it royalty? Wait, do you have to have an Amazon seller account, or is it royalty based? I guess he's talking about Merch by Amazon.
Actually, it's separate. You don't have to have an Amazon seller account, and it is royalty based. And so actually I would say the average price those books sell, or the royalty, is about $2.
Oh, he's talking about
Createspace. Okay. Yeah, Createspace. So it's all royalty based. It's print on demand. You make them. I know of a couple people that are doing it, have been doing it for a couple of years, and currently they're making probably about $6,000 to $8,000 a month. So they're doing pretty good.
Lord Apat says, I don't have 1,000 tier. I wish I had 1,000. I read that question wrong, but I guess he's capped out. He's probably a 25 or 100. And you know, we've been in that situation before, and it's always good to have designs on hand, especially like winter is coming. That should be a thing in merch. Yeah. Winter is coming. We don't know what's going to happen with that. So we actually have a few topics today. I wanted to quickly talk about the pop sockets. You know what? I've already lost track. I already took the show completely off the rails. Joe, how are your numbers been this month so far?
Let's see. On Printful, I'll say that has picked up for me, and I probably had like 5 sales so far this month. So that's been really good. And then on Merch by Amazon, I actually have the numbers. but let me find it real quick. But I think I've had probably like 40 sales so far this week. So yeah, it's going okay.
So you've had 40 sales in the last week or this month?
Oh no, this total in the whole total month.
Oh, total month is 40. That's still pretty good, man. Like that is really.
Yeah, I've had 45 sales this month. Actually, you know what? This has been like the lowest month I've had all year, it seems like.
Now, is this, I'm sorry, is this merch by Amazon or is this Printful?
Yeah, merch by Amazon.
Yeah, okay. Amazon. Yeah. Yeah, that's, you know, what's funny is we've always said this before, like, oh, I've only sold 100 shirts this month.
Yeah.
And like to like someone who's a tier 25, their mouth like drops to the ground. Like, oh my God, I wish I can sell 100 shirts. You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of funny that, did you have any, do you have your Printful numbers or any of your pop socket information or anything like that? Or is that part of your total?
Yeah. I think I've sold 2 pop sockets and then, 5 Printful shirts. Yeah.
Yeah. You're definitely, I think with the pop sockets, it's one of those things where you got to find, you got to crack the nut. And we'll talk about that in just a second. My numbers, I've sold 152 pop sockets so far this month. I would say my total is probably over 300 now, since I was actually part of the first wave, if you can believe it or not. And I didn't even upload pop sockets till like maybe 2 weeks after the first wave. Because when I'm going to be completely honest, when I first heard about these, I was just like, I don't know. Like I didn't want it. My time is short as it is, but I should have jumped on it like the second that those came live, because there's a lot of people that only got in during the second wave. You know what I mean? Yeah, and then there's some people who haven't even been a part of it. And so I was lucky enough to jump in with that. So 152 so far, crossing my fingers on that. We're going to talk about that in a second. There's some ins and outs on that. I only sold 29 tees so far on merch by Amazon this month. My shirt sales have been lower and lower and lower ever the, like maybe in the last 6 months. So I got to work on that. It's my fault because if I don't upload like I should. And as a matter of fact, when I noticed when I started to upload pop sockets and upload like maybe a couple designs a day, I was seeing increased sales. And I know people tinfoil hat that and say that that's not a thing, but I'm telling you, when you start to upload, there's something that happens in the algorithm that starts to trigger sales. Joe, did you ever see anything weird like that, or am I just tripping?
Oh, it just like just changes on you, or what, the algorithm?
No, what I mean is like if you don't upload anything and you're seeing slow sales, and all of a sudden you start uploading a few things or change like a price or something, you start to see sales like immediately.
Yeah, totally. Because currently I edited 100 shirts, 200 so far, but the first 100 I did just the other day, and I've already sold 2 shirts that never sold before, and just because I changed the price, they sold.
Yeah, it's crazy. Printful sales, I've had about 11 orders, and that's not just 11 units. I get a lot of multiple quantities in my orders. I noticed like maybe 2 offs or 3 offs or things like that. So that 11 orders, that's a little low. My Printful numbers are definitely lower than they have been on my all-time on May and all that stuff. Speaking of pop sockets, if you're in the chat room and you have not been able to sell pop sockets yet, please put a 1 in the chat. I'm curious to see how many people are left. I think there's a pretty good amount of people that aren't selling pop sockets. Joe, do you have any information on that?
For the pop sockets?
Yeah. Is there still people that aren't being able to sell them?
I think there's still people who have not been approved for pop sockets yet. They're still waiting around. And I bet maybe they'll get them by the end of August if they don't get them soon, you know. I hate to say that, but that's how they kind of are. They're kind of finicky about that.
So. Yeah, it's crazy. We got also a thing about right here. We got Patricia Dodd in the chat. She's saying, I have about 160 shirts on Etsy. I've only sold 5. I get a lot of likes, but no sales. Is there any special way to list that I'm missing? Joe, right off the bat, do you have anything that comes to mind just hearing that statement?
Yeah, are you doing promoted listings? That's what I need to know, because I kind of have like I when I first started Etsy, I was told to do promoted listings. I did promoted listings. I started getting some sales, and then I go, well, maybe I don't need promoted listings. I took it off. My account was dead pretty much all of June. I put it back on in July, and I got sales like right away. So I'm messing with it. I'm playing with it. I'm like, so it's it's kind of making money. And actually, I was searching for my shirts, and I'm like, oh, they are showing up at the top of the list when people in this certain category. So it is worth it to have promoted listings if you can afford it. Because, well, there, I can't afford it because it's almost like it's paying for itself by the sales I'm getting. So,
yeah. And for those that don't know what he's talking about, if you go to Etsy, I think it's in advertising or marketing on the little tab.
Yeah, marketing, I think.
Yeah. And for those that don't know, there's actually two types of marketing that he's talking about. One is, I think it's like featured or promoted listings for Etsy. Mm-hmm. And there's also a Google promoted listings too. And do you use both of those?
I experimented with the Google and I wasn't getting any sales. And maybe I've gotten one sale from Google. I've been getting the majority of from just inside the promoted listings of from Etsy.
Yeah. And one tip I can give you, Patricia, if you're seeing slow sales on Etsy, is to maybe go back and look at your keywords and your description and see if you're doing your keywords properly. Cause I've been watching and reading a lot of stuff on Etsy the last year. And one of the major things that a lot of the gurus are talk about is keywords and things like that. Because basically when someone is going on to Etsy, they're looking for something specific. So, you know, having like, you know, I don't know, Mother's Day gift as a keyword, you know what I mean? Like there's stuff like that, that you need to start looking at and optimizing your search results. And I found when I started to do that, I started to see increased sales, and now it's like a normal thing to basically just make sure that, you know, not necessarily keyword stuffing, because Etsy does not like that, but to like put maybe a sentence in your keywords, like use a complete sentence like someone was searching for. And probably one of the best tips that you're ever going to get about Etsy is if you're selling something specifically, is go to the search engine and type in what you're selling, and then see what pops up automatically. And then, cause that's going to be what's working in the system. So if you have a Father's Day gift, put Father's Day shirt, and then see what other keywords come in after that in the search. And then it's easier to figure out, you know, there's a rhyme and the reason to everything. It's going to take a lot of work. Joe, have you tried that?
Yeah. Well, here, check this out. Okay. So there's a thing when you make your listing, I had this one program called Marmalade. It was like a monthly subscription, but I just tried it for 1 month. And what they were saying was put your, you know, title and your, you know, fill it out pretty good, you know, with keywords, and then fill out your description, but make sure those keywords are also, because you get 13 tag words, keywords that you can tag at the very bottom of your listing. So make sure those kind of match up and fill them all out, all the 13 keywords. And so here's an example. I was posting up some elementary back to school shirts, and this is just one example of it. And actually, what's cool about Etsy, it gives you really good analytics, so you can see what people are searching for. For this one shirt, it's told me, on some shirts it says zero search terms. On this one, it says 13 search terms were searched for the tags that you put on there. And here's an example for the tags. It tells me I put school teacher and I put kindergarten, and then it tells me what the buyer searched for, and the buyer searched for kindergarten teacher shirt. And by my tags, they found this shirt because that's what they were searching for.
Yep. Well, there you go. I'm telling you, it's all about the keywords, because if you think about it, here's another thing too. Here's another pro tip. And this goes for any kind of sales online or anything. Put yourself in the shoes of the buyer. And I've noticed that when you put yourself in the shoes of the buyer, you seem to figure out what keywords are working and things like that. Instead of, 'cause like for me, you know, we're all like, go, go, go. We're in the mindset of the seller. But once you start to figure out, you know, put yourself in the shoes of a buyer, what are they looking for? Like if I was trying to find this merch talk shirt, you know, how would I go about and find that? And then kind of optimize that for your listings. But definitely there's lots of ways to do that. I want to give a couple of more shout outs here to the chat room. IM says they took your Udemy class, Illustrator class. Is that, am I saying that right? Is it Udemy?
Yeah, I think it's Udemy. Whose class?
Your class. Do you have an Illustrator? Do you do Udemy or what is it? I don't even know how to say that.
No, I don't even do Udemy.
Oh, wow, that's so funny, because like I guess she might think we are someone else that we're not.
Who? Who? What is that?
I am. It's a little bit up. It says, okay. I took your Udemy class, Illustrator class. Okay, never mind. Also, Traveling Troy says, hi, guys. Merch talk. Sweet. Watching this video from my camper van at the south rim of the Grand Canyon. Very, very nice. How about that view this morning, Joe? The Grand Canyon.
Yeah, I wish I had that view right now. All I got is thrifter here.
Compared me to the Grand Canyon is definitely not a.
You're in California, right? Everybody in California lives next to the beach, right?
No, that's not how it is. Like,
are
I live.
You sure?
Yeah, well, I mean, we're about. I think anyone in Southern California is like 45 minutes from the beach. Speaking of the beach, man, that sounds actually really, really cool. As sad as this is going to sound, I'd rather be at the beach than the Grand Canyon.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So let's talk about Amazon Prime Day. This has kind of been a little bit of a sticky subject here on Twitter. I was actually enjoying all the tweets and all the comedy that was happening and all the memes. I love memes. Memes are everything. And do you want to talk about a little bit about your experience on Amazon Prime Day? Did you try to do any promotions or do anything like that merch related?
What I did mainly was I wasn't putting the word pop sockets in anywhere, like, you know, but later I found out that you can put in pop sockets grip, because I had an interview with Rachel Dorsey on Friday, and she sold over like 200 pop sockets in the 1st of July, just like the first 13 days. And she's like, do you not? I sent her like one of my pop socket designs. She's like, you don't even have the word pop sockets grips in your title or your description. She's like, you need to do that. So I went edited a bunch of those, and then I went repriced them. So the only success I had is the repricing of the shirts from the shirts that I sold that I think that had primed help. So,
yeah, I actually watched that interview and it was very impressive. And I actually, I don't have much time, so it's very rare for me to actually enjoy people's content, but I saw that interview and I'm like, I'm gonna get into it. And it's kind of funny when you watch YouTube videos, you kind of watch the first few minutes and then you're like, I don't know if I want to watch the rest of this, but I was actually, I was at the edge of my seat for the whole episode. And by the way, if you guys are like me where you don't have much time, if you go to the little socket there, the little gear, and you put two times, you speed it up to speed the videos up two times, you can save a lot of time by watching videos at twice the speed. I know some people can't handle that, but I've also found out by people from YouTube that you actually get the full watch time, Joe, for your analytics. Even if people watch it in twice the speed, you still get the full time that is there. So I highly suggest anyone that is, you know, into that doesn't have the time but wants to do the research to watch and listen to podcasts and things like that in two times speed. And I'm telling you, it's like we're like robots. We're trying to cram in as much information as possible.
And one thing I want to add to that is I recently added a Merch University podcast. So if you go to iTunes or if you have Stitcher, you can listen to that Rachel interview on iTunes on your phone when you're driving to work, whatever. I even added two episodes from the past where I interviewed Mike Gwall, who sells over $1 million every month, pretty much on, you know, for merch. And then I have the Michael Essany interview on there. So.
Yeah, lots of great stuff. Joe's having doing a really good job. I don't have his link here for the live show, but if you're watching this on the back end, I'm going to leave a link to Joe's channel below. Definitely go and subscribe to his channel. And speaking of subscribing, if you're not subscribed to my channel, Thrift Shop Hustler, please click that subscribe button as soon as possible. Also, if you're enjoying this video so far, definitely click the like button. That gets others interested in things like that. So speaking of pop socket titles and things like that, let's talk about a little bit about my takedowns that I had last week. We could talk a little bit about that. You were just talking about putting pop sockets in the titles and the bullet points. I definitely highly suggest that no one put pop sockets in the brand name, because you will get a takedown. I had a couple takedowns this weekend, and it was probably from my most popular sales. I've sold actually a couple designs of over 50 designs, Joe, if you can believe it. And wow. I had pop sockets in the brand name. I don't want to say exactly what I was using, but pop sockets was in the brand name. And at first, Amazon was actually allowing this because it was going through processing. It went through its normal quality control check and everything went through. And so I thought, okay, I'm just going to 10X this and all my listings are going to have, you know, like, I don't even want to say what I put, but you know, pop sockets was one of the terms in the brand name. And then Amazon came back to me saying, you know, we're going to take this down. And so I highly suggest that you don't, well, actually now you get a rejection. That's how I found out too. I had to find out the hard way. I didn't email Amazon because that sometimes takes forever. I had to figure out what was happening because I was getting, you know, a rejection. And I'm like, oh, what am I doing wrong? And then once I took out pop sockets out of the brand name is when my stuff started to process. So have you been hearing anything about that, Joe, on the Facebook or anything?
I haven't heard. I've after you told me, I started seeing a few people that were getting like rejections and stuff. And you know, here's another reason why I never added pop sockets, because it was when I was reading it, it says we're going to add it to the end of your title anyways. But so that's probably why I never did it. But I got a good example. When I was editing them, I was editing like 100 at a time, and I was going through changing it using that Amazon batch editor. And it was really quick. And so I was going through them one at a time, and I got a rejection. I go, why did I get a rejection? Because out of those 100, I did one of them. I put pop sockets as the brand on the end of my brand title. I'm like, oh, great. And so I changed it. It got uploaded. No big deal.
So what I noticed is my two takedowns that I had were the ones that I sold over 50. So it wasn't like I had to actually go back and change the other ones that I did. I think I was maybe like 30 or 40 in by the time I was like, oh shoot. So I noticed that they only cared about the ones that were selling well. They're like, oh wait a minute, this guy's doing very well in this particular listing. And so I was lucky enough to catch the other ones before they get the takedown, because you get the email takedown that says you're in trademark violation. They don't unfortunately, what I don't like about the Amazon takedown emails is they give you like a very vague thing. It could either be a trademark or a brand issue or whatever. They don't give you any specifics, which I wish they did, because it'd probably save them a lot of time from people emailing them back being like, what happened? What's going on? But I guess it's automatic and it's Amazon and everything like that. Yeah, man. Like but anyway, so I went back and I changed all my listings and things like that. So I'm starting to notice sales with my other non-pop socket brand names. So, you know, things are still working.
What one thing I want to add to that is, okay, check this out. So I'm in there and I'm like, okay, I read the TOS and it said, okay, you can add it in the title and the bullet points, their own merch Amazon TOS. I read it. And then so I emailed them. I'm like, oh, is this correct? You can put it in the title and bullet points. And then, you know, you would think, oh yeah, yeah, a correct answer would be, yeah, that's correct. You read it right in the Amazon TOS, and that's correct. You can put in title bullet points. Their reply was, we can't give you any legal advice. We can't tell you nothing. I'm like, I asked you about your own TOS, not anything that I added, your own thing that you wrote on your own website. And yet you can't say, you can't tell me if I can do that or not do that. It was weird. Something that was so concrete that they wrote on their site, they couldn't say, yeah, you can do that. I didn't get it. That's weird. So
I mean,
they're going to be very vague with you on their own stuff that they write on their own website.
I mean, it kind of makes sense too, because when you're dealing with large corporations, they want to protect themselves. And I'm sure they've got, see, the thing is, you know, we've been in this business for a while. I've been here doing merch for, I don't even know, like maybe 2 years, but you learn, you know, what not to post. So I can imagine someone who's new to merch by Amazon, who has no experience with selling, going and uploading Batman logos. You know what I mean? Like the total blatant ripoff of IPs and things like that. So I'm sure they're dealing with so much intellectual property disputes from just people that are just like, they get accepted and then they upload the Batman logo and they're like, you know, there's like, DC's like, what's going on? So I can definitely see that. So man, that's crazy. So yeah, if anyone has any questions in the chat, definitely leave your questions. We'll sit here and we will answer your questions. That's pretty much all the topics I have, Joe. Is there anything you want to talk about? Free
form? Yeah, let's talk about that pop socket one more time. I put it in our messenger so you can see it.
I don't. Oh wait. I don't see it, man.
It's in our group messenger.
Oh, on Facebook.
Yeah. So we can look at it if you can look at it.
Yeah.
Real quick. And so that's what I want to discuss about. I was talking to Helen Kinson today on an interview, and she was telling me that that she came up with her own keywords for pop sockets. And actually, if you remember the Rachel interview, she was talking about how if you use like certain keywords, and all the keywords that she was telling me about and all the keywords Helen was telling me about were all like girly terms, if you want to say that, like keywords. And I was like, I would never have thought of that, you know, because I'm not that I do that. But so she was said, if you go to Merch Empire, they have a free pop socket. It's called Pop Socket Time. And somebody researched and they made a list of 100 pop sockets. And I even placed the link in Merch University just a few minutes ago. So if you want to go check that out, it's a free pop socket research, and it's a list from 1 through 100. Did you see it?
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. It's actually pretty impressive, and it's actually funny that some of my best sellers are in the top 10 list here. So that's pretty funny.
So, okay, from this list, for people who can't see it, like the number one is cool pop sockets. How would somebody since you have a good amount of sales, how would you say how could you use that if you had like a subject of like basketball? How would you list your title?
Are you saying with the cool pop socket thing?
Yeah. How would you from that term, that number one term that they have up there, how would you use that with the subject of a niche of basketball?
A basketball, I would say like, fun, cool, basketball team. You want to kind of use the other terms that. So basically how I do my keywords, and this is probably just the way I do it, is you take. Imagine keywords like a pyramid, right? And right now you said basketball would be the top of my pyramid. So basketball is the top one. And then all the words that come down from that, like team, player, ball, like anything like equipment, sports, everything's going to come down from that. So that's probably how I would format it would be like, cool. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. That makes sense? So like for the title, you could say, would you use the main niche first, or would you use cool first?
Well, that's a good question. I would probably put cool first, because it just sounds
really.
I would think you would want to put cool basketball pop socket and then fill the rest in, because.
Wow.
Yeah, is that wrong, or is that
no? Because I guess this is how people are searching for things. Maybe when they're typing in, they're going, "I'm looking for a Galaxy pop socket." Right. I guess and so and actually, maybe the keyword is Galaxy, but Galaxy is also the niche too. So
yeah, I try to do the. It's funny because I bring in the Etsy kind of experience into merch when you kind of want to, you can do the same thing where if you put Galaxy pop sockets in the search in Amazon, you'll get other keywords that attach itself to it. Mm-hmm. So I usually try to make my listings, at least my titles, flow. Like I don't put like cool basketball, summer, rubber ball. You know what I mean? I don't put just keywords. I put something that actually flows.
Yeah,
through the title, and I've actually found success on pretty much any selling platform when you do it like that. But when you do keyword stuffing, I haven't really seen a lot of success with just keyword stuffing.
And I think so that works because when I'm searching for, say I was looking for a Galaxy pop socket, I'm not going to be like, mentioning all these other terms. I'm just going to say Galaxy pop socket. I'm not going to be going all crazy, I'm not going to be going animal, cool, cute, marble, pop socket, I'm going to be.
Yeah.
People don't search like that. They just search like cool pop socket or pop socket for boys or cute pop socket and stuff. So, yeah.
Yeah, and it's funny because it's actually kind of funny because I'm gonna just be totally honest here. That 100 list, I'm just looking at it right now. That's what I was doing for my brands.
Okay.
Cool pop sockets, this pop sockets, that pop sockets. And wow. So I think that's what jumpstarted a lot of my sales, is that's what I was doing. Cause I was taking niches and then I was umbrellaing them. Like I'll take like cool pop sockets, and then I'll have all my cool pop sockets, and I'll have all my giraffe pop sockets, and do all that.
Wow.
So I was noticing, you know, I was dominating a lot of niches and pop sockets for a while till they did the trademark thing. And then I've noticed that it's kind of like evened out the field a lot, because, you know, what I'm thinking is maybe the actual pop sockets brand was noticing that, and they were noticing like a huge drop in sales.
Oh, probably.
And here's the thing, money will always ruin friendships, ruin relationships, and it will also bring people to notice things. If you're a big company and someone's messing with your money, that's when changes happen. That's when things happen. So I can almost guarantee that, you know, Pop Sockets, the brand, was noticing a drop in sales, and they're like, well, what's going on here? And then they had, you know, they looked into it further and were like, yeah, that's not cool. People can't use prop sockets in the title, because that's our, you know, intellectual property. But it was going through the system, so I thought it was cool. Yeah. I didn't think I was doing anything wrong.
So you've sold what, maybe over 100 pop sockets already?
No, I sold over 300 pop sockets
already. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, dude.
That is crazy.
I sold probably on my first week like over 100.
So how many do you have live currently?
Oh, I don't know, man. Let me go look. Actually, I'm going to go look and see how many actual, what I can do is, I can't give you a number. Is there any third party apps that would actually show you how many pop sockets you have live?
I don't know. I think there is, but I'm not, I think those are paid.
Yeah.
Not that I know of like right off hand that you could use.
I think the best thing I can do is actually go into my folder and just highlight all the, or select all, and then see how many photos are.
Would you say you have more than 300 pop sockets?
No, not even.
Not even. Wow.
I think even less than 50, bro.
Oh, wow. So that's really good. That's really, actually, man, that makes it more enticing to start making pop sockets instead of shirts, you know? And actually, I think Amy Nicholas, she has that live show for Merch Money. And she says that her strategy is 90% pop sockets and 10% shirts.
Yep. That's what I'm.
Everybody's saying like they're going to go off in Q4. So.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so I just highlighting my images I have in my folder. I have 119, so there I have probably about 119 listed so far. And like your friend said, I when I saw pop sockets and they were starting to sell, I went like pretty much 100% pop sockets.
Yeah. I mean, so did I. That's why I put up like I have like 400 of, but I only have like 2 sales. But like I said, I was just doing whatever. But then once I started talking to people who've done it before, they were like, you should do this, you should do that. And I'm like, okay, I'll try that method. So
yeah, I did a lot of research, dude. Like, I'm not even going to give away like what I did, because it was,
don't pretty, give it away.
It is actually pretty clever and everything to figure out. It's actually not that clever. I mean, it's like obvious. If I said it, everyone would be like, why didn't I think of that? Like, but you know, just, I did my research. I'm going to say that I did my research and I figured out what people were buying and what were popular. And, you know, I could have probably made that list that you just saw, that 100 list, from just the research. I'm sure they pulled that information from a database or an API and everything. So it was easy to generate that list. And it's actually a true list. And that's actually really cool that they're giving away for free. But I was actually creating something like that without physically like writing it down. I would research and I'd be like, oh, let me go down that avenue. Then I'd make 10 pop sockets on that. And then I'd be like, oh, that's cool, I like that, let me make 10 pop sockets of that niche. And that's how I was going about it, because I don't have a lot of time. So I don't have time to do 100 designs.
Yeah.
Hey, designing them is easy. I mean, kind of prepping them is easy. Designing them is kind of hard to figure out what works and what doesn't, and then what you need to spend your time on. And yeah, dude.
That's crazy. I'm excited about pop sockets, and I need to start making some more of them immediately. After this, I'm going to make 1,000.
He's going to 10X. You're going to 10X it.
10X it. I don't even know what 10X means. I mean, I know what it means, but I think it's a book or something people read.
No, I think Grant Cardone is the guy that do you know who Grant Cardone is?
I've heard of his name, but I don't really know anything about
him. He's like a Gary Vaynerchuk guy, guru, marketing, you know, one of those guys, but he's very famous. And I think he actually did a book that said 10X, and it's kind of a lot of people kind of latched onto that. And kind of, I kind of say it kind of tongue in cheek, 10X it, you know, like, so you're going to 10X it if you have 100 listings. So I didn't even know that. So I got 119 listings. I had to go back and change like maybe 40 of them once that trademark thing happened, because I didn't want to have another good seller go away.
Did you re-upload it and just take out pop sockets?
Yeah, the ones that got takedowns, the ones that were still live, I just went in there and changed them.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah, because like I was saying earlier, the thing that I noticed is they only took down my most popular ones that were selling a lot. You know, the ones that were selling maybe one or two here or there, they didn't care about, but the ones that sold over 50,
yeah,
they were like, wait a minute here. As a matter of fact, I got the takedown. I don't know. Let's just say I got the takedown on a Monday, and they were still selling through that Monday. And I'm like, I'm all, do I delete it? I don't know what to do. Like, and so I left it because I don't know what happened. I totally forgot about it. And then the next day I was still getting sales. And then that Tuesday they took it down. When you clicked on the link, it was gone. So then I was just like, oh man, I totally forgot. I should have took it down before. And things like that. yeah, dude, like it's scary, man. Like merch is scary with the takedowns, man. I mean, people are shaking in their boots with the rejections and things like that. And I would say, like, I'd be more worried about the trademark violations and the takedowns rather than the rejections.
Yeah. Hey, I want to do something that, since we got this list up, like for people that are watching, let's give them something like that's pretty good. Since you've been selling something, I want you to pick one of these on here that is not yours, but okay, something that you would do. Say you were making a pop socket right after the show, and you're going to go in here and you're going to pick one of these. Which one would you?
Oh man, that's that's a great one, dude. Let's do that.
Let's give them something good. Yeah.
It's funny because let's look at the top 20 here.
Okay.
Pop socket for boys, cute pop sockets, marble pop sockets, galaxy pop socket, pop socket designs, black pop sockets, rose gold, white, pineapple. I would probably actually look, I would start researching the pineapple ones and start looking at that. Okay. I've noticed, and this is going to be a tip for you guys. You know, this isn't going to be one of the shows where, oh my God, Chris is hoarding information again. Here's a pro tip. Fruit does very well with pop sockets. You can take like one little fruit and then multiply it, make like a pattern, like almost like a wallpaper, put a bunch of little fruits and then put like a background, like maybe like a light blue or a peach, a solid color. And I noticed that, like, you might think like, God, that's really ugly. But here's the thing. What I'm saying, you need to put yourself in the shoes of the buyer, because we get caught up in thinking like, and this is, I'm not going to lie, I get caught up in this all the time. I make stuff of things that I like. And you need to get away from that mindset. You need to start making things that the consumer likes, that the buyer wants. So making little fruit patterns, and then maybe putting like a light blue or a pink background, like a light pink background, and then trying those. Those are very popular. But yeah, dude, I can go down that whole list and make probably 10 things.
From each one.
At least easily from each one of those things.
So a person probably wouldn't have they would probably have some kind of success if they found like the niche and then kind of like did it like a wallpaper and then put a background behind it. That would be a good starting place, right?
Yeah. Because the thing too, I think a lot of people are going into the pop sockets with the shirt mindset when it's its own beast. It's like saying like, you're selling cars and then all of a sudden you're selling skateboards. It's two different things, you know, it's two modes of transportation, but they're completely different. So I think you need to also, as a pro tip, pull yourself out of the t-shirt designing mindset and get yourself into the buyer slash pop socket mindset. And I think that'll actually help a lot.
And actually, I was looking on the popsocket.com, their actual website, and they show you what's trending right now. And their like number one idea is like a cactus, just, and it's just like you said, it's like cactus, cactus, cactus. And then they have like a white background.
Yeah.
And that's it. And that's their number one seller. So I can see from what you said is that that's what people are searching for. So, hey, let's roll with it. Do our own.
Exactly. I mean, like I said, I did a lot of research into what was selling, what was not selling, what was working, what was cool. And I did take some of my personal opinions into it, into account. I didn't go all like, what would the buyer buy? When I even went to other places online to find, just go to some other pop socket seller online through Google and start looking to see what designs they have, not necessarily looking to see what's trending, but go to look to see what catches your eye. And I noticed that things that I liked, I'm like, oh, that's cool. And then I would go like do 10 designs in that niche.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there's lots of ways to do it. And you know, what's funny is like, we're still in the Wild West right now with the pop sockets. They just came out. The competition is low because not everyone's doing it. There's going to be a time, I would even say like soon, that everyone's going to be on pop sockets and the whole market is going to be destroyed. I'm going to say it right now. The market's going to be destroyed.
And it will actually hear what I was thinking this myself. Okay. So, I've been hearing like other third parties who try to do pop sockets were getting like the pop sockets brand was going after them and shutting them down. And so when I was thinking about that, okay, you got the pop socket brand, but then the only people they're letting extending that license to is Amazon, which really means us. And so just think about it. We're the only ones making pop sockets are us on merch and the brand. And so, and then if you think about that even further, if you go, okay, well, who's making t-shirts? Zazzle, Cafe Press, Etsy, Printful, Merch, T Public, Teespring, Amazon. I mean, like there's like 50 PODs and everybody is making shirts, but there's only two companies that are making pop sockets, and that's me and you, and the brand pop sockets. And so it's like the frontier, man. Just make sure, you know.
It's only a matter of time before the market is saturated, just like the shirts. I'm calling it right now. Like, you know, we hope that Q4 is going to be awesome for those that are doing the pop sockets right now, but we don't know. They might let everyone in just before Q4 and then totally like, and here's the thing about saturated markets. What I like about saturated markets is it actually proves your worth in this game. It forces you to kind of think outside the box. It forces you to create better keywords, better bullet points, better designs. So I actually look forward to those days where it's going to be saturated, where I can say, well, I have to redo my game plan.
Yeah. And well, and you could say that with the t-shirt market, with all those 50 PODs that have doing it. I mean, how many shirts are up? I mean, that's really saturated, the t-shirt market is, but I mean, you can still make money. Everybody's making money off t-shirts still. So
yeah. Yeah.
It'll be
so
okay.
We'll see what happens. We had a thing in here. Hold on one second. I knew it was here. So Patricia Dodd is asking, do you use bullet points with pop sockets like the t-shirts? So I think she's asking like, do you kind of format your bullet points just like t-shirts?
Do you?
Yeah, I do.
I have been. I've just been adding extra. I've been writing it just like normal. So, yeah.
Yeah. You know what's kind of crazy is some of my best-selling shirts don't have a description or bullet points. So the thing is, everyone, we're all trying to figure out what the secret sauce is, I guess, when it comes to bullet points and keywords. And I'm here to tell you, tinfoil hat on and everything, I don't know if it really is that important, because some of my best-selling shirts don't have bullet points and don't have descriptions.
And the reason when you said that, this reminded me, I was at last month I was at a green room seminar in Austin, Texas, and there was a guy, like a guru for FBA, and he was talking about keywords too. So that like perked me up, because I'm like, I'm not doing FBA, but once he started about talking about keywords, he was filling out his whole title pretty much with as much as you can, and he was describing this light. And so he was just describing it the whole time of like, everything was to the light. And I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. And he's like, this is how your item's going to get found. Cause then I think he was even talking about with private label too. So.
Yeah, no, it's true. And I said about keyword stuffing, you can, I would definitely highly suggest people try it. I've noticed, you know, certain things that work for me, and what works for me is not going to work for you. And that's another reason why I don't say like exactly what I do, because what I exactly do might not work for someone out there in YouTube land, or, you know, you're going to be able to find, and you've been around Joe long enough where you've probably taken advice from someone that is like a top seller, and then it doesn't work for you.
Yeah, that's true. Cause I do that, but I also try to do my own thing too. So.
Yeah, exactly. And so if we don't have any more questions, do you have anything you want to plug today, Joe, or anything?
Nope, that's it, man. I think we had a good show today.
Yeah, we went heavy on the pop sockets, which I think you feel that, you know, Q4 is going to be all about pop sockets.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's all going to be about pop sockets. So, yeah. So I think it's good.
Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. When I first started loading pop sockets, that's when I started to notice people on the street with them. And I know that my nieces and my daughter wants one. And I noticed that, you know, the younger generation, they love them. And so I knew that something was happening here. And someone in the chat was saying something about a fad. Yeah, maybe not. Like, my hands are pretty much all jacked up from holding my phone over the last like 20 years. So have you bought any of your pop sockets? I have not.
I haven't.
I know Margaret did a cool video about reviewing her pop sockets. And for those that don't know, definitely go and check out Texas Gal Treasures video. I don't know how many videos it was ago, but yeah. So Joe, thank you very much for stopping by, man. I'll leave Joe's link to his YouTube channel below. Definitely go and do that. Click the like button, and also check out my Printful Etsy affiliate link down below. If you're not selling on Printful, definitely go and check that out. Any last words, Joe?
Nope. Just I put that that list to all those keywords in Merch University. So go over there, check it out, get it. It's free. So
awesome. Well, right on, man. Thank you very much, and we'll see you guys next week. Take care.
Later. Bye.